Okay, so I will start about talking about Earth, mankind and energy in a rather general way. I've chosen a presentation which is not too technical, but of course this is a technical issue scientifically, so I'll try to get moving and we get going on this thing if I can understand how these things work. Okay, let's go. So introductions. Now, the availability of adequate planetary energy is one of the essential future needs of mankind. After a short summary of the past history of the planet Earth, I shall present a discussion of the present primary energy supply, and I will discuss some of the new options for the future. A progressive switch to renewable energies is advancing, but no doubt fossil will continue to be used for many decades to come. A new method for fossils is here described at the end of my talk, mainly applicable to natural gas, where the energy will be generated, but with no appreciable emission of CO2 or other greenhouse gases. Since CO2 emissions are then fully removed, the method may represent a valid alternative to the ongoing renewable energies like wind, biomass, and solar. In this way, also some fossil resources may be finally used equally safely in the future. The new computing methods, now, first of all, now there is new method developer computers have changed enormously the way of looking at the phenomenology in question. In the past decades, our understanding advanced considerably, due largely to computers which allow extensive calculation and numerical model integration over a long time scale, especially in the future. On a human scale of kiloannum, kilo year, 1,000 years, planet motion is a model of remarkable regularity. However, on a longer times, planets are chaotic, resulting in future unknown orbital paths and eventually leading to severely disrupted solar systems. For instance, while in a regular region, two planetary trajectories can become arbitrarily close in space, will diverge as a power, usually linear, of the elapsed time. In a chaotic region, the nearby trajectory will separate exponentially. For instance, for a typical error of 15 meters in Earth's initial positions, after 10 million years, brings an error of about 150 meters. But the same error may grow after 100 million years to as much as 150 million kilometers, making impossible the precise precision of the orbits. So there the future of this is modified by this chaotic behavior. Now, let me start talking about the Sun. The energy generation of the Sun is based upon thermonuclear fusion of hydrogen into helium. It occurs in the core region of the star based on a proton-proton chain reaction processes. There are several processes which I don't have time to discuss. At present, nearly one half of the hydrogen of the core has been already used, with the remainder consisting primarily of helium. As the number of hydrogen atoms per unit masses decreases because of the burning, it causes the core to contract with an increased density and temperature, causing the remaining hydrogen to undergo fusion at a faster rate and the steady increase of the energy output. So the Sun is growing in intensity. Initially, the Sun, as a main star sequence star, radiated only 70% of the current energy. The luminosity has been rising about 1% every 100 million years. The hydrogen fuel at the core will finally be exhausted in 5 billion years when the Sun will be 67% more luminous than today. The Sun will then ultimately evolve into a red giant and in a compact white dwarf. Now, the Sun as a main sequence star is represented here. In this plot is a very tiny little point, 0.01 diameter. After 7 billion years, the full expansion into a red giant will occur up to a radius of 1.2 astronomical unit, 180 million kilometers. You can see this effect of the sun before and after the process in the red giant. Mercury and Venus will be totally absorbed by the sun. The Earth's orbit will be reduced and probably also absorbed towards its final destination. So there will be no Earth, no Venus, no Mercury. Earth may break apart the moon with debris impacting on Earth, whose mantle and crust are removed, leaving the core. Finally, the sun will begin to collapse again, evolving into a compact dwarf, a white dwarf, after ejecting its outer atmospheres as a planetary nebula without a planet in orbit around it. And you can see here the picture of a model of it, helix planetary nebula, the sun will produce in about 7 billion years. Now let's talk a little bit briefly about Earth. The solar system has about one-third of the age of the universe. It was formed about 4.54 billions of years ago by accretion from the solar nebula, a disc-shaped mass of dust and gas. About 2% of the mass was made of the Earth variety of ordinary elements, the rest being unburnt stellar fuel. Collision to a with a planet-sized body has generated a moon after a few million of years. Earth outgassing a volcanic activity produced a primordial hydrogen-free atmosphere. There was no hydrogen at the beginning, oxygen at the beginning, oxygen-free atmosphere. Water, augmented by us, delivered from comets, produced the oceans. After 2 billion of years, oxygen with a thin ozone layer incremented life under the seas and on the surface. Continents were created and moved around for 100 million of years. The complex multicellular DNA-driven life, the multicellular DNA-driven life on Earth, was almost entirely born during the last 600 million of years, strongly affected in its evolution by several huge, unexpected mass extinction and major catastrophic events, with a loss of 99% of all living species. The primordial atmospheres contain no oxygen, so it would not have been toxic, so it would have been toxic to most of modern life. A solid crust and liquid water were formed with time. Earlier, undisputed evidence for life are microbial methane-fed fossils, such as stromatolites found 3.848 billion years sandstones. After exposed minerals were oxidized between 2.5 billion years, oxygen finally began to accumulate in the atmosphere with the extinction of most of the planet anaerobes, to which oxygen was toxic, with their progressive mutation into the aerobes. The huge number of tiny cyanobacteria producing during long time, billion of years, the energy through photosynthesis have been the source of the organic oxygen in our atmosphere. You can see here some picture of a cyanobacteria responsible for the oxygen on the Earth atmospheres and so forth. And of course, the oxygen revolution of Earth has been one of the most significant events of Earth. Now, just to be more precise, you can see here how the oxygen was created on the Earth. You can see a plot here with five stages. There are five. Down below, you can see 2.5 billion years, 3.5 billion years, 2 billion years, 1 billion year, and then today. And you see the amount of atmospheric oxygen produced. You can see the red and green lines represent the range of estimates, and that means that the oxygen is a relatively coming into the activity somewhere in various stages, as indicated here. Stage one, practically no oxygen. Stage two, oxygen rises to 0.02 atmospheres, but in the oceans. Stage three, oxygen goes out to the oceans, to land surfaces. Stage four and five, oxygen accumulated to the atmosphere to the present 20% of today. The presence of oxygen, of course, has produced huge changes in the chemistry between rocks, sand, clay, and other geological substrates, and the Earth, air, oceans, and other surface water. So it's a major fantastic effect which have been in this for billions of years of activity of these very tiny little things which have been going on and eating up away some producing some growing quantity of oxygen. Now, however, although the temperature of the sun kept rising, the earth did not get warmer. Indeed, rather it cooled dramatically. Glacier deposit in South Africa dated 2.2 billion years and then located the equator show the earth is totally frozen. Such ice age around 2.3 billion years ago could have been directly caused by the incoming oxygen concentration in the atmosphere, which caused, as an alternative, the decrease of the presence of atmospheric methane. There were four periods, each lasting about 10 million years, between 750 and 580 million years ago, with Earth thought to be covered with ice at average temperature of minus 50 degrees. The process could have finally been reversed in a known way, maybe by the emission of carbon dioxide from volcanoes or the destabilization of methane gas hydrates. But there are other alternatives possible. There is, for instance, a slush bowl alternative. Even at the top of the ice ages, there have been some open water at the equator. So whether the water was absolutely complete or not is still something which we debated. Another main event in East history has been mass extinctions. More than 90% of all species, amounting to the over 5 billion species that ever live on Earth, have been extinct. The first main known mass extinction was the Oxygen Revolution 2.2 billion years ago. The other big five cannot be so clearly defined because of the presence of this relatively smooth continuum of extinctions. And they are indicated here, 440, 375, 251, 200, 66 million years, and so forth and so on, which have been exposed, eliminated in this process. Many, many different forms of life has disappeared, indicated here in this very long list. Now, you can see here the diagram of the main extinctions. You can see here the time. To the left, you can see 600 million. To the right, you see today. And you see where the main extinctions have occurred. However, you can also see the most important one was the Great Dying Event, indicated there. But however, you can see from the plot that, in fact, these lines are not unique. There have been a continuous phenomenon of main extinction all throughout the time, with the peaks being only more important than the continuum, as I said before. The sixth, or Anthropocene, is the presently ongoing extinction, which is produced by us, mainly by our mining activity. This last present extinction has already killed numerous plants and animals. At current rates, about 30% of species are at risk in the next 100 years. Now, let's look at the story of Earth progressively going for 65 million years until today. You can see that the behavior of the Earth in the last 65 million years indicated here. You see temperature has been higher. You can see here in the graphic to the rest that today's value and the value of 10 degrees above the temperature. You can see the time coming from the left to the right. And you see the famous PATM, which is a thermal spike, which is a very remarkable event, which has, as you see, consequences to even today's life, called Paleocene Eocene Thermal Max, PETM, which has occurred in this little line you can see up there, which is, I've explained, enlarged a little bit as a picture in there. With some progressive reduction of temperatures, about 35 million years ago, glaciation in Antarctica even appeared again. You can see also that happening from 35 million on. Glaciation of Antarctica are also visible up there when the temperature have reduced a little bit themselves. Now, this is the same picture drawn in a different way. You can see here the time, and you can see the present day temperature, and you can see here the PETM event in there, and you can see the long line where Antarctic ice sheets and northern atmosphere ice sheets have been slowly degenerated, arriving to the today situation, which you can see down the bottom to the right. PETM is phenomenon, this peak, narrow peak, is an analog of a possible future global warming. This is why it's so important for us to worry about that. PETM is a very short lived high-temperature excursion, probably associated to the destabilization of the methane clathrates, which are huge frozen methane ices that accumulate in the bottom of the oceans, and the fast build-up of greenhouse gases. Now, clathrates are also present, as you will see in a moment, we'll discuss later, very vast amounts also today. Excuse me. During the PETM, the global mean temperature seemed to have risen as much as 15 degrees with respect to the total global average temperature. This effect may repeat again after a few future centuries of uncurbed man-made anthropogenic changes. It is likely that the full magnitude of the PTM rise may have been underestimated substantially, maybe a factor of 2 to 4. At that time, the temperature in the Arctic had reached level of modern temperate oceans. The poles were free of ice caps. The palm tree and cocoa isles lived up to the Arctic Circle. And much of the continental United States, China and Europe, have been subtropical environment. Now, let me address myself to another important question, which is the existence of carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide during the last 600 million years, now, the last CO2 values were many times higher than now, although the exact value may be in doubt. 600 million years ago, atmospheric CO2, not carbon dioxide, was about 20 times larger than the present values. You can see here the graph showing the time and the effect of the carbon dioxide. To the left, you have 600 million years, and to the right, you have 600 million years, and to the left, you have today's temperature. It dropped and then rose again 402 million years ago, you can see from the graph here, to four to five times the present level, a period which saw the rise of a giant forest without flowers. The flowers were, by the way, the flowers were only very late in the present Earth, and then continued slow decline until recent pre-industrial time. You see that point at the end in that little corner. I have a way to get a picture image, I don't know. Do I get a light here? Do I get a pointer here? No. Well, I don't know. I don't know where the pointer is. Yeah. Well, I try to survive without the pointer. Do you know how the pointer is? Professor, do you know where the pointer is?
Absolutely.
You must have known that thing before. It belongs to you.
No, it just doesn't have a pointer, this one.
Ah, brilliant. You're a genius. Thank you. So I was showing here the pointer. I was saying, today we are here. Here was 600 million years ago, and this is the amount of carbon dioxide as a function of time with various models and measurements indicated there. Okay, let me continue. Here we go. The burning of fossil fuels is the leading cause of increased CO2, now at 400 ppmv. In 2010, 214 gigaton carbon of fossil were released compared to 615 in 1990, so it's a very fast increase. Land use changes also contribute to the effect of gigaton of carbon. If you go to a closer scale, to the last million years is characterized by glacial and interglacial period of gradually deepening ages. You can see here the picture, again, as a function of time. Now I can hit it. You can see here 1 million years ago. Here, at this point, there is a separation. The scale, you see, is changed by a factor times. So this is up to here, and there are periodic changes between the present temperature, 0 degree, this one, and glaciation, much lower temperatures, in which most of the Earth was at a lower temperature, about 10 degrees below. And you can see here the beginning of our present situation, which is about 10,000 years ago, and you can see it, how it combines, and there is the places where hypotheses indicate the possibility of an additional change due to the man's contribution. This glaciation involves fluctuation driven by changes in the Earth orbit known as Milankovitch cycles. So the phenomenon of this fluctuation, this glaciation, is perfectly unknown. And Milankovitch has explained how to do it. It's due essentially to the movement of the orbit of the Earth. 400,000 years ago, there was been an unexplained switch in the dominant periodicity, as you can see from the graph, from 41 kilo years to 100 kilo years. You can see the effect in the graph up there. And currently, since 10,000 years, Earth is an interglacial period. It's now we are in a condition of remarkably stable temperatures, never been before in such a long time. Now, let me show this picture, which is a very important picture. This picture comes from an experiment in the Vostok core from Antarctica. Monsieur Petit and others did that. And they measuring the 18 global concentration, they can calculate the temperature, the average temperature of the Earth as a whole. They are in Antarctica, which is very cold, far away. But since they measure the oxygen 16 over the ordinary 18, they measure something which relates to the Earth as a whole. So in spite of that, they give you the idea of where the Earth temperature was. You can see here from this graph in here that essentially the last 400,000 years, there have been long periods, very long periods of glaciation, you see, down there, where the temperature is down by 10 degrees below. And very few periods, extremely narrow period, in which we are getting to temperatures which are, by the way, warmer than the present. This point there, there are 2 degrees extra in the present. When we say that we want to stay within 2 degrees temperature from today's date, we indicate the 2 degrees which were there already by nature at that time in this period of time. And these are the very short periods. So we can live only there. In those, the other places, everything is totally frozen and we will not be able to survive. Now, you can see here where the agriculture starts in there. You see the modern time, and you see all the figures you have there. Now, therefore, there are very few warm periods, which are shown in red, which have been exceptional, lasting only for a relatively short time. If you see, the total is only a few percent of the total time. So therefore, this is how the Earth behaved before the arrival of man in the past. And you see where we are at the present moment. Now, the situation should be not to be underestimated, because that last pass to the Earth is very similar to what will presumably happen also in the future. And the question is, what about future glaciation? Is a future glaciation inevitably ahead? Now, since about 10 kilo a year, the Earth is in a Holocene interglacial period, as I said. The warm period with expected only to last for no more than a few kilo years. The melancholy theories predict the glacial period periodically covering the higher altitude of the continent will occur cyclically because of astronomical factor in combination with climate feedback mechanism. However, the increased rate of the carbon dioxide released by man may indeed be favorable in a certain sense because it may delay the onset of the next glacial period. On the other hand, the present global warming period of finite duration, based on the assumption that fossil use will cease in a few centuries, will probably only impact for about a few kilo years this arrival glacial period. Therefore, our global warming induced through few centuries worth of greenhouse gas emissions may have a longer impact. However, the future glaciation today could be absolutely dramatic for the 8 to 10 billion people which are now living in the place. So let me now go to the next step, which is the human evolution. A small African ape has been the last link between modern apes and chimpanzees, and it occurs about in the graph indicated there. You can see there the Homo habilis, the Homo erectus, and the Homo the Neanderthal man, and the Homo, so over there. You can see the time, you see the years there, 4 billion years until today, with the indications of the various phenomena which occurred this time. The ability to walk upright developed about 4 million years ago. Brain size increased rapidly. And 2 million years ago, the first animal classified as Homo appeared. So 2 million years ago. Fire began with Homo erectus, probably between 0.8 and 1.5 million years. Language is more difficult. It is unclear whether Homo erectus could speak or if their capability had not begun only with Homo sapiens. Modern humans, Homo sapiens, are believed to have originated around 200 years ago, or early in Africa. The oldest fossil date about 160,000 years. The first humans showing signs of spirituality were the people from Neanderthal. And here is shown very quickly the colonization of Earth. You can see here how in functional time Europe, Africa, and Asia, the Americas were invaded, occupied. And you can see that, in fact, the Homo sapiens reached after 11,000 years, the southern tip of South America, indicated there. This is the various picture which represent the past of our civilization. Now the important question which I like to ask, what happened to Neanderthals? It's estimated that they speak, the total Neanderthal population across the habitat range numbered around 70,000, which was an enormous number for a period 40,000 years ago. Fossils were being found from northern Germany to Israel, Spain and Italy, from England and from Portugal to Pakistan. You can see the picture here, which is a very nice picture showing the situation of the Neanderthal men. This is the, let me advance that, this is the area, limits of permanent ice. This ice was permanent there. It's also permanent ice was present in the Alps. Here, most of the Austrian Alps were completely covered with frozen ice all year long. There are also some ice traces over there, and some of them here. And then you have all this huge population of people developing all over the places and covering this situation of, you see, Italy, Israel, you know, Russia, and most of the northern Europe, just up to the edge of where the ice, permanent ice, was. Now, the research has also has not accepted a conclusive explanation of what caused exactly the Neanderthals' extinction, which occurred very rapidly between 40,000 and 28,000 years. Hypotheses include failure to adapt to colder climate, it was very cold at that time, competitive exclusion, or extinction caused by no more than human. Maybe the war started already then, and they have liquidated the Neanderthal people occupying our own self. By the way, 4% of our own DNA contains information which is related to today's condition, which is connected to the presence of the Neanderthal man. So there is some mixing and some crossbreeding between Neanderthal and ordinary people. Now, colossal, another important phenomenon occurred 38,000 years ago. You can see that eruption has been classified 7 out of 8 in the Spallanzani Index with a dense rock emissions of 300 cubic kilometers. And you can see here the area over which an ash layer of more than half a meter covered all this region. However, it's unlikely that they have caused the Neanderthal extinction. And of course, in this area live today more than 150 million people. If such a thing will have to repeat itself, it will repeat itself sometime in the future. We are going to talk about hundreds of millions of people which have to be lose their life because of this phenomenon. This occurs near Naples, the beginning of the process. So, summer global temperature pattern will cover my fundamental presentation. You can see fundamentally that there has been, here is the last 2,000 years before Christ. Here is the Jesus Christ center, and here is the future. And you can see effectively that we are going, the Earth by itself has been going on between periods of higher temperatures and lower temperatures, indicated there very clearly that, for instance, at the time of the, at the time of the, here you can see, for instance, the effect of in early times, 1,000 years before Christ, the temperature is much higher than today. And you can see here, this is T equals zero, this is the beginning after Christ. You can see a period of warm, cold, warm again, a little cold age which occurred at 1700. And then you have here this situation, which is today's situation. What I want to mention from this is that essentially, the present ongoing one period has been so far by no means exceptional. If you look at all the other systems, you can see that in fact this is perfectly obvious that it should be something like that around. Okay, let me continue. Now on 2,000 years, it's shown more clearly this phenomenon. You can see that the small ice age in 1700, and from the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, already in 1700, the temperature has been rising. It's not true that the temperature has been something recent. Since 1700 onwards, you can see here, the temperature of the Earth, the average temperature of the Northern Hemisphere, has slowly grown from a minimum up to the maximum in a sort of linear way. Okay, now we have a new phenomenon. And the new phenomenon is the emergence of anthropogenic era. The permanence of the unique, long-lived, stable period after the lasting glacial period has been essential to create, sustain life and civilization as there are today. And it is an essential element that we must survive at any cost. But, as well known, we are facing a novel phenomenon which was coined by Eugene Sturmer and popularized by the Nobel laureate Paul Crutzen, namely the emergency of a man-made anthropogenic era. For the first time, human activities may influence the future of the Earth's climate. The main element has been the extraordinary growth rate of humankind. The first signs of anthropogenic era have been hidden, have been already detected. Of course, these effects should be curbed to avoid irreversible consequences of major climate change. Everybody knows the famous 2-degree story, etc., and all the situations like that. Now, today's growth rate, what it is? Today, every second, 21 people are born, 18 die. With a net gain of 3 people per second. Every day, the population increases by 220,000 people. The growth rate has been intensely rising and is currently approaching 90 million new people per year with a rapid blow-up of a population explosion. For instance, we have a novel Austria created every month. Such an immense increase of the human species is only one of the most rapid evolution of our planet, and no doubt is conditioning the future of man as well as one of other animal and vegetal species and of future climate. The total number of individuals which have ever lived on Earth is estimated between 70 and 150 billion. Because of the exponential growth, as many as 6 to 10% of all human beings which ever populated Earth are alive today. This is, of course, an exceptional situation which leaves us very outstanding. Likewise, there is a growth of energy demand. At the beginning of the year 1800, population 1 billion, the average power was about 1 kilowatt per person, about a half of a horsepower, 10 times the human power. The man could only do 10 times which he could do with his own hands. Since 1850, energy has grown twice as fast as population. You can see the curve represented here in this graph. You can see that in 1850, we had a very low value of energy. Because of the increase in population, you can see that the energy consumption also increased much faster than the population. You can see, in fact, here that we have down here, in 1910, we were 1.6. In 1930, 2.28, which is roughly when I was born. And here, in 2020, we are 20. So another huge factor of difference developing. This is the number, the population in billions, and this is the terawatt year produced in total. Okay, let me continue. During the last 80 years, the global population grew by 3.42 times, and the energy production increased 11.7 times. By 2050, we shall be reaching the 10 billion mark. Now, another important example, in the 2000, mankind consumed 14.5 terawatt a year, a per capita equivalent 2.3 tons per year per person, and this is the same order of the per capita nuclear weapons. Every year we produce enough energy corresponds to all the nuclear weapons put together, or in alternatively, the energy required to launch every human being into space. We have enough energy to throw everybody into space, every single human being into space. From the US, of course, the value is much larger because US is using 14 tons per year per person. Now, the value of energy represents today 10% of the global GNP. Energy with lower emission and qualitative significant management based on the progressive elimination of CO2 emissions have to be vigorously pursued. But in order to ensure acceptable future development, it is reasonable to evolve simultaneously on two parallel lines. One line is the more efficient utilization of fossil fuel, limiting the effect of the anthropogenic CO2 and the other emissions. This is what I'm going to discuss later. And second, the development and progressive utilization of renewable energy sources like wind and solar. However, the prediction of IEA are not very successful. You can see here a graph showing the growth over the last 25 years. OECD countries, which are mostly flat, a very major increase in China, in Orient, and which leads to an increase of about 30% in the total energy produced. You can also see that the amount of the energy growth, according to International Energy Agency, is mostly due to fossil burning, and there is a very modest increase of renewable, including hydro and natural gas. So this is a rather business as usual situation, which is certainly not a promise for the future. Okay, now the accumulated, sorry, I have the other thing here, most included, okay, on the other end, the worldwide investment in renewable energy, by the way, is $214 billion US in 2013. Now, the accumulated effect of the CO2 and other gas effect of CO2 can be easily calculated. You see the graph down there, the effect for 100 petagram, which is of CO2, and 5,000 petagram of CO2. Now, 1,000 petagram of carbon will correspond to an increase by year 2100 to 700 point part per million, and the other, of course, will be much higher for 500. You can see what happens from this curve here. This is the time indicated. You can see here the scale for the next 10,000 years. And you can see that over the 10,000 years, what is the emission by various models on the amount of CO2 emitted? Sorry, here it goes. Here's the one there. Yeah, just a moment. Changing scale you can see here. The pre-industrial value is indicated there. And you can see that there is a substantial amount CO2 emissions, which will last more than 10,000 years, or practically forever. Okay, now I can see that it doesn't work anymore. It doesn't give you, there we go. You can see that indicated there. This at 1,000 picogram is go to 700 ppm here by the end of the century. You can see that phenomenon occurring there. Okay, let me continue speeding this problem. Okay, now, of course, there is a growing concern about the CO2 accumulation. Cumulative emission, integrated emission, have reached a huge value of 400 billion tons of carbon equivalent. So there are 400 billion tons of carbon equivalent, which have been now sitting in the atmosphere. You can see on the right line there, fact that because of the big increase due to the presence of China, there has been a graphic growth, but there is some indication that after all, in the last few years, the CO2 emission per year has remained constant. It doesn't mean that you are not increasing CO2 emission. It means you are not increasing anymore in the rate at which the thing is increasing. But the integrated value is always present there with a very great significance. Now, in 2015, renewables accounted for 90% new electricity generation. So that means that effect is important, but not sufficient. Really, the choice of the representative concentration pathways in IPCC are indicated by this graph, which I think is an important graph. You see here the way in which we are today. Now, are we going to go this way? Or are you going to go that way? Or are you going to that way? And this is 240, 206, 280. This is the kind of problem which is open to us. And this to the various possible alternatives, which as far as we are concerned, are completely closed. They all most of these diagrams still show that the fact that this thing is flattening out does not mean that it is going to be possible to fix it. Something around 2030 will be the moment in which you decide where you go up this way or down that way and so forth and so on. This is essentially the way in which things are developing. The present circumstances. Now, I will give now briefly an example, use Germany as an example because it's close also to UAE, Austria. And thermal power is the backbone of electricity supply, providing today 95% of the total load in winter time and 60% in summer time. So, thermal power. The ratio of local actual productivity per year to the theoretical maximum is called the capacity factor. The German nationwide wind power capacity factor in 2012 was only 17%. So on the average, only 17% of the maximum value is what is being used. In 2015, the penetration of energy produced by wind for the world electric production was much smaller, only 3.5%. Now, resources of off-coast winds are hampered by so far inevitable underwater construction costs, and photovoltaic is also far more expensive than fossils. You can see here the graph again for Germany. You can see the cheapest coal indicated there. You can see the various other elements which are associated with fossils, which you can see in there. The cheapest coal is 4% of a dollar per kilowatt. And you can see that the other wind are represented there, while the onshore wind, I mean the wind near the building, it is getting close to the, really close to coal. You can see that the offshore wind, the one you go when you go and pick up the wind away, 100 kilometers away in the middle of the sea, is getting much worse. And so is the photovoltaic, you can see, is also quite substantial. So there is today a substantial still gap to go between renewables and fossils in order to make the system comparable. Now, the wind variability in Germany is already shown here. You see, look how difficult it is to work on wind. You can see this is the wind power in Germany in 2000 census functional time. And there are times in which the wind is too much, and the time in which the wind is too... This is the power emitted by the wind in a given condition. You can see how this explains the 17% out of the total maximum. For a vast transformation into solar wind, intrinsic variability must be compensated with power storage supplied for other energies, huge power overcapacity, and extended transmission over longer distances with high power electricity. The cost of electricity is a function of the fraction of renewable is shown here. You can see a plot here in which in amount due to renewable, and the other one is the cost of electricity indicated there. And you see the various countries, including Germany is an example. And you can see here that indeed, while in Germany, because of the renewable at 1 kilowatt, which means 20% of the total energy, you have a cost of electricity which is twice as large as the cost of France, which is nuclear, and US, which has very essentially little or no access to renewable compared to us. This is something which one has to keep very much in mind. Now, in addition, you need in Germany a very large amount of gigawatt transmission lines. You can see them here in this picture. Here you can see the line which are going to bring the wind from the north where the offshore wind is down to the south where the people are. And we require to construct something like 3,800 kilometers of power, many gigawatts, which has to be transmitted to various places. Powering the world with 100% renewable energy is a stated goal of many individuals and organizations. However, since it is feasible to make 100% renewable to generate electricity, it is not possible in the near term, for instance, to replace motor fuels. The fuel part is not a part of the reconstruction of this kind of activity. Now, let me skip this point because time is getting rather short. And let me continue then to the next page, which is here, likely future of the energy consumption. Now, in 2013, all renewable contributes 19% to energy consumption and 22% to electricity, but the new renewable, geothermal biomass, contribute only for a few percent. In order to curb emission, most expectations in the future predict a huge growth both for natural gas and renewable within a factor two. This is what is expected in some kind of predictions, which are, in my opinion, quite realistic, showing essentially that while the coal will stay essentially constant over until 2040, the renewable and the natural gas will both be rising very rapidly. So the renewable is, of course, a factor two increment in about 30 years, and the natural gas will also go up quite significantly. Okay, now, the contribution of natural gas is a very important question. There are two ways in which natural gas can be used, either conventional or unconventional. Conventional natural gas is the one produced drilling a hole into a porous permeable rock formation, which lets the gas flow out on the rock up to the surface. Unconventional natural gas is absorbed or trapped in an impermeable source, shale gas called bed methane, or bound with a crystal lattice, which is called methane hydrates. Gas for shale is produced by hydraulic fracturing, where a mixture of water, sand, and chemical activity pump at very high pressure. You can see them here. Here is the picture of the shales, how you connect the shale with the hydraulic fracturing. And here you see the coal bed methane, as you collect it again, extracted by drilling wells in a coal system. And these are the two new methods of the new system. Worldwide shale resources are globally massive. You can see here the picture worldwide shale. Every country has a major possibility. This coal bed methane, likewise, is also plenty of possibility. And the European resource is also very rich, especially, essentially, Poland is one of the countries which is there. Germany is particularly empty, but there is a lot of activities elsewhere across Europe as an alternative. Now, there is another piece of story, which besides, which are the so-called clathrates. Very few people know what are these clathrates. Let me describe them briefly because they are a very large source of new energy. You can see here the amount of clathrate are about 12,000 gigaton carbon compared to the coal emissions, 5,000 gigaton, and the oil resources, 200. And they are essentially gas which is produced, stable. It's a combination, as you say in the picture, between water and methane. A chemical substance, a molecule of water, form an open solid lattice which encloses without chemical bonding a appropriately sized molecule of methane. Methane and water combine themselves. The concentration is very high. 1 liter of methane clathrate contains 168 liters of methane gas, a GNP. And you can extract this this product, either extracting it, as you can see here, with from the boat, from underground, or from the permafrost, and you can collect that amount of system rather easily with methods which are perfectly obvious. Clathrates have been observed almost everywhere. You can see here where the global clathrates have been observed. You can see that most of the coast around the major continents are available for collecting extremely large amount of of clathrates, which is, in fact, is a new resource which is certainly worth considering. Okay, so if I have 10 more minutes, if I may, 10 more minutes, I would like to continue the presentation. Natural gas option to reduce the CO2 emissions. 3 methods are compared here. The first method is natural gas, which is produced either in one way or the other, which is then captured. CO2 capture is produces CO2 emission, half of what it would be from coal. From coal. The second alternative, too, is here, in which the carbon capture, the CO2 capture, is collected and stored underground, utilized as a possible alternative. And the third possibility, which I'm going to discuss now in detail, is a product in which a natural gas, methane, CH4, is transforming itself to black carbon and hydrogen, and therefore there are no emission of CO2 altogether. So in point one, we do nothing. In point two, we do storage underground for a very long period of time. And in solution three, we simply produce an alternative solution in which we produce black carbon and hydrogen, in which the natural gas is producing zero CO2 emission to start with. So we'll touch very rapidly the three alternatives. Now, the conclusions, by the way, that you say, are coming from the Royal Society, which they say the safest, the most predictable method of moderating climate change is to take early and effective action to reduce emission of greenhouse gases. No geoengineering method can provide an easy and readily acceptable alternative solution to the problem of climate change. A geoengineering method could, however, potentially be useful in the future to augment continuing effort to mitigate climate change by reducing emission, and so could be subject to more detailed research and analysis. So the real argument is no new engineering can solve alternative solutions to the problem of climate change. Okay, now, here is one example. It's an example of geoengineering to compensate CO2 emission. This is essentially storing carbon dioxide underground in the ocean. This is what is called CSS, carbon sequestration. And now the main problem there is essentially the argument that as you indicated there, the 1986, the NICOS, a volcanic CO2 leak of something like 10 to the 6 tons has been killed. All the people which were there caused by the presence of the fact that the CO2 acts as a powerful Wien dilatator. Now, in order to ensure 550 ppm by 2100 with the option business as usual, according to TPC, we must accumulate something like per carbon capture sequestration, something like 2×10^12 tons. So it's extremely difficult to arrive to such a solution. The other alternative is mineral carbonation. Here you essentially take, you essentially, in this process, transform the coal. 1 gigawatt electric power station produces 360 tons per hour coal, require, however, an accumulation of 2,000 tons olivine to be able to do that. I mean, multiply by 10 the amount of mass to eliminate the carbon is certainly not an alternative solution. And the third question is aerosol cooling, which is described here, which is the injection of SO2 in the atmosphere. You see here in this picture what you do if you were to add a certain amount of SO2 in the stratosphere. You can see the adding some amount of CO2 in the atmosphere, you can collect, you can reduce the global warming. However, the problem is very difficult because SO2 injection may disrupt the monsoons. And this is another very important question. You can see here the picture of how the aerosol injection after 10 years is acting. This is without introductions of SO2 cooling. And if you add SO2 cooling, you can see how the Earth, you can see from this picture, is changing color, which is eliminating completely the effect of the SO2 heating. So you can keep the SO2, but you add CO2, but yes, SO2, you can do that. And then is the last part of my presentation, which is point 3A, revival of fossil without CO2. Methane cracking and methane decarbonation is a spontaneous thermal dissociation at sufficient high temperature of methane molecule into atomic component, which is CH4 and carbon. Hydrogen becomes the final form of energy. Total absence of CO2 is the main reason for the development. Cracking methane with no CO2 emission uses no more energy than the standard reforming process, which however produces as much as 4 tons of CO2 for each ton of hydrogen. The big carbon can either be sequestrated or sold in the market as a material commodity or reduce cost marketing the carbon as a filler or the construction material. A vigorous pre-industrial development is going on in collaboration with effort with the German Institute, which, by the way, Kit, and also we had some work with Potsdam. Now, the process is shown in here. Let me skip this part again, because of time. The liquid metal alternative, the preferred option in most of the previous studies, is based on molten metal, as carbon separation seems to be more achievable due to the density difference between liquid and the carbon. And essentially what you do, a process producing hydrogen from methane or methane-containing gases using molten iron. Several authors pursue a technology with mixed results. You can see here some carbon powder. And you can see here how the detector was constructed, the one which you're working on. You can see here early the conversation to bubbling of natural gas through a molten metal at high temperatures. You see the liquid is brought in, and then it goes through the bubbles crossing the liquid and arriving to the top. At the top, the carbon is separated from the hydrogen. The hydrogen is extracted, and the remaining natural gas is recirculated, and this is producing essentially a very nice results. And molten liquids are lead, iron, tin, and also others which can be used. Now, the two methods are very similar. Here you can see the standard method, MSR, and the SDDM method, and you can see they're very comparable in efficiency and behavior. And here is shown this experimental setup, which we developed ourselves. See, it's a small device. The hydrogen effect is very clear. The hydrogen E is a function of the temperature, or that is indicated by the red line. You can see, in fact, that at something like 1,000 degrees, you get a major transformation of hydrogen from this process. And this is essentially shows how this quantity varies as a function of the amount of gas which is transmitted. And therefore, this is a successful experiment. The result, the technical feasibility of methane TDM decomposition in liquid metal bubble collector has been demonstrated. And the no single pass, the single pass to 78%, it was obtained, and during the present experiment, no clogging issues due to solid carbon deposition on reactor valve occurred. The produced carbon mainly accumulated above the liquid metal interface in powder to form particle sizes of 15-20 microns. Disassembling the reactor after 15 days of operation, only a thin carbon layer around 10 micron thickness was found. And now the final brief point is the question of making a liquid fuel. Much has been said about the money spent for the hydrogen economy as a substitute of oil. Hydrogen is a chemical product where we use a number of fields, which include, for instance, production of ammonia, cracking of petrol. Its production is 4% of the one oil, mostly from natural gas production. Notwithstanding, fundamental problem will have to be solved if hydrogen gas will ever become directly a practical everyday transportation fuel. That could be filled into engines and easily, safely as gasoline is today. A hydrogen car is not for tomorrow. The chances that the seem prohibitive. In many people's view, the necessary future substitute of petrol to transport must be a liquid containing both hydrogen, CO2, and CO2. A main alternative is to produce liquid methanol. Liquid methanol is a convenient material, which has been discussed here clearly. And let me show you what is the idea, which is my final discussion, transparency for you, with passions and a few more minutes. And you can see here what happens. You see on the right-hand side, you have here the CO2 produced, collected by some kind of a source. And you see to the other line, the productions of hydrogen coming from CO2 less emissions. So here you collect CO2, here you emit no CO2. You combine the two things and you produce methanol. Methanol comes there. And then the basic process is fossil neutral gas methane combined with CO2 recovery. And you can see out of that you can produce a liquid, and the liquid can be used in a variety of systems to transport to storage oil in various alternatives. And the spent CO2 can be recovered a second time in many of the applications. Now, with methanol, you can do all kinds of chemical products, which are indicated there. And the process, of course, as I remain, is recover CO2 as a chemical material to recycle from some conventional source of concentrated CO2 waste, remove things already paid for recovered CO2. We can combine with hydrogen, for instance, produce with black carbon, and without CO2 for decarbonization. CO2 and hydrogen may produce methanol and water, a liquid substitute to gasoline. If methanol or substitute is burned in a concentrated source, its CO2 could be definitely recycled. Otherwise, CO2 may be reused, returned back to the atmosphere. Future supply options are nuclear and solar energy for hydrogen and the capture for the atmospheric system. So let me make the conclusion. In addition to the project with renewable, the continued production of energy from fossil is mandatory. According to an old saying, at the end of the Stone Age did not occur because of the lack of stone. Likewise, in my view, at the end of the coal exploitation era, there will be still a huge amount of coal left. Oops, sorry. Where is it? This one. Methane decarburation, which takes CH4 into hydrogen and black carbon, in association with natural gas, can be a valuable alternative to renewable energy. Since having removed the CO2, it has the capability of becoming another safe primary energy source adequate for centuries. Both as a hydrogen gas or as a liquid, either as a gas or a liquid with methanol and already used CO2, it can be made environmentally acceptable with a minimal footprint and without costly new infrastructure. Now, provided the emission of CO2 can be economically removed with the black carbon and our sample method, why should we not be vastly used in the future and without environmental drawbacks? And this is my question, which closes my presentation. Thank you very much.